Hello and welcome to Show and Tell with me, Stephen Leslie. This series, actually, let's be honest, it's more of an occasional series now. So the occasional series where I occasionally show you some photos and then occasionally tell you about them. It's been a while since the last one of these, and I'm recording this on one of the hottest days of the year in London. So if I start sweating profusely throughout, it's both due to the heat and just lack of practice. So what are we going to talk about today? Well, this is episode 21, would you believe it? Regular dedicated viewers might remember that way back, the very first one I ever did of these was about bald men in street photography, a subject which I feel very qualified to talk about because I obviously am a bald man who takes photographs. A few episodes later, we talked about another passion of mine, which is elbows in street photography. Again, something that I feel qualified to talk about because I have two rather wrinkly elbows of my own. So what are we going to talk about today? Well, continuing our inevitable passage down the body, I thought we'd talk about, that's right, you guessed it, feet. Again, I feel very qualified to talk about this because I have two rather large feet of my own. In fact, hang on a second, I take a UK size 12 shoe, so I've got two very big feet. Although they very rarely appear on camera and they're usually about 6 foot away from me. But I do think that feet in street photography or street feet is a subject that hasn't really been covered. So let's have a look at that today. Now, before we get started, what are we going to call this episode? I'd spent a long time thinking about this. Initially, I was going to go with Reclaim the Feet, but I thought that was a bit too much of a niche pun. Feet photography instead of street photography didn't really quite do it. So instead I've gone for foot fetish, and I've done that purely for clickbait to try and lure a few more people in to watch this thing. So let's do the titles and then we can get going. So why feet? Well, I know this might sound a bit tenuous, but arguably the first ever street photograph was a street feet photograph or street foot photograph, and it was this one taken by French photography pioneer Louis Daguerre way back in 1838 on the Boulevard du Temple in Paris. And you can see that not only is it a street feet or foot photograph, but it's a shoe shine photograph, and it's a historic bit of shoe shining, and I've very handily put a red ring around it here because it's quite difficult to see if you don't know what you're looking for. Now, something else that I want to try and do in this episode, because I'm a masochist, is to try and include a photograph of the feet or shoes of every photographer that I end up talking about. But I'm afraid I might have fallen at the first hurdle here, because after a depressingly long search online, I am pretty willing to state that there are no existing photographs of Louis Daguerre's feet or shoes anywhere in existence. Now, obviously, he was around a long, long time ago. There weren't many other photographers to take photographs of his feet. So the closest I can get is this, which shows the top of his thighs. And as I said, Daguerre was around a long, long time ago, and so there's not that many photos of him to choose from. Still, it's a pity to be thwarted so early on in this episode, but stay tuned and hopefully you'll get to see more photographs of photographers' feet and shoes as this episode progresses, you lucky people. So yeah, street photography arguably started with a photograph of a bloke getting his shoe shined. And shoe shining is a very good subject for street photographers because the subjects tend to be immobile, distracted, and looking down at their shoes. And this is slightly annoying to me because way back when I did my film on William Klein in Soho, which was Show and Tell episode 8, we looked very closely at his tremendous London shoe shine photo from 1980. But I totally forgot to mention or compare it to the Daguerre photo. Here, though, is a photo of William Klein's feet, or his right foot at least, and again, there aren't very many of them online either. The only decent one I could find is this very late photo of him in a wheelchair from 2015, taken by Roy Rocklin. And then also, last time out, when I spent almost an entire hour banging on about Stanley Kubrick, I also totally forgot to mention his 1947 unpublished photo essay for Look magazine about a day in the life of a shoeshine boy called Mikey. But better late than never. Here are some of Kubrick's shoeshine boy photos. And now that you've seen them, here is a photo of Stanley Kubrick's own shoes on the set of Dr. Strangelove taken by Ouija. I like this photo because it's as if Kubrick is taking a shoe selfie, and we'll have many more of those later on. And here is a great colour photo of Kubrick on the set of Spartacus with his trousers rolled up. And yes, that's right, revealing his rather shapely pair of bare feet. Now, would you believe that you can even buy Stanley Kubrick-themed socks? So if time travel were possible, it would be feasible that Stanley Kubrick could be wearing his own pair of Stanley Kubrick socks on the set of Spartacus. But here's the bizarre thing. Even though you can buy Stanley Kubrick socks for A Clockwork Orange, The Shining, and even Full Metal Jacket, you can't buy Spartacus socks, which is a crying shame. Also, the Kubrick sock collection manufacturers have surely missed out big time by not offering a Lolita sock, because Lolita, as everyone knows surely, starts with this 2-minute single pedicure shot, arguably one of the greatest foot shots in all of cinema. So you could have Kubrick Lolita socks, but actually you can't, so there. Anyway, I'm sure if I really wanted to stretch it out, I could do an entire episode on great shoeshine photos, because that's what we were talking about way back before I started getting distracted by Stanley Kubrick's feet and socks. There's also this shoeshine photo by Lewis Hine, so that's a Hine shine shot from New York City in 1924. And here's a photo of Lewis Hine himself, sporting some very conventional shoes that match almost exactly the shoes in Hine's shoeshine photo. Although, unfortunately, he's not also wearing the same hat as the shoeshine boy. Or there's this great photo by Wolfgang Suschitzky, or maybe that should be Wolfgang Suschinski, from London in 1936. Suschitzky is a great photographer, and I have an entire episode on him planned for the future, but finding a photograph of his feet was a nightmare. He died in 2016, aged an incredibly impressive 104, and so all the photographs of him, or virtually all the photographs of him online, are of him sitting down, because he was very old, like this. So no feet on display at all. But then I had a huge bit of luck, because on an auction website, I found a load of his archive was being sold off. And there, amongst tons of old negatives and prints, was this, a portfolio housing approximately 100 working C prints of assorted subjects, including an interesting reflective self-portrait. And fortunately for me and you, in this interesting reflective self-portrait, we can see Wolfgang's right shoe in this ancient selfie, probably taken sometime in the 70s or 80s, when he was still spry and nimble. Then there's this unconventional but storming photo by Saul Leiter from New York City in 1950 called The Shoes of the Shoeshine Man, which is truly fantastic, as not only does it reveal the poverty of the man who shines other people's shoes for a living and contrasts them with a slightly out of focus pair of fancy women's high heels in the background, but it also shows his socks, which, when I first saw this photo, made me almost soil my own boxer shorts in excitement, because it seemed as if maybe, just maybe, the shoeshine man with ill-fitting shoes was sporting a pair of Stanley Kubrick's The Shining socks, showing the famous patterned carpet from the Overlook Hotel. And then I thought, wait a second, Stanley Kubrick did a photo story about a shoeshine boy, which we've just seen, and then he made a film called The Shining. I'm onto something here. And so what if, in some alternate universe, Kubrick actually made a film called The Shoe Shining, a masterpiece of modern horror about an overzealous shoeshine boy possessed by a demonic spirit. But then I remembered that this was Saul Leiter's photo, and it was taken a full 30 years before Kubrick made The Shining, and really, for everyone's sake, I better stop going on about all that now. Because what I need to do is show you a photograph of Saul Leiter and his shoes. And I found this one from the 1980s, where you can see he's modelling a rather drab brown pair of moccasins. And here's another lovely shoeshine photo taken by Fred Herzog in Mexico City in 1963. And here's a photo of Fred Herzog himself in some rather trendy, comfy-looking trainers from 2000. And you can see he's sticking his camera into the window of a locked shoe shop where he was trying to photograph some rather fetching knee-high red leather boots. And finally, I'm going to show you a rather more recent Jeff Meremelstein shoeshine photo in a second. This is from his second book, no title here, which I think is just as good, if not weirder, than Sidewalk, which is the one everyone talks about, but is now impossibly expensive. Although I have just noticed, as I'm doing this, that if you look at the back of Sidewalk, I don't know if you can see it there, There is a picture of a woman putting a shoe on, or she's just broken a heel. So shoes, shots are everywhere in street photography once you start to get attuned to them. Anyway, moving on. So this Meremelstein shoeshine photo is great because it mischievously reverses the assumptions people may have about shoeshining. It's playful, but it also reveals the political potential in shoe and feet photography, as Saul Leiter did before him, and which we're going to be looking at in much greater detail later on. And here, because I've started this thing and I'm now going to have to stick with it, is a photo of Jeff Meremelstein's feet. This was also a very difficult image to source. Meremelstein is quite tall, and so not many photos of him include his feet. I found this rather recentish one of him in action in Manhattan, wearing some really quite funky green trainers and taken by Frank Multari, but I wasn't happy with it. It's too backy. But then I was watching Everybody's Street, which is a great doc, and you can find it here on YouTube, and it contains a rare old photo showing a very young, like late 20-something Meremelstein with an afro crossing the road in New York City in the early 1980s. And even though his shoes aren't very distinct, I like this photo far more than the more recent one. Anyway, we'll return to Jeff Meremelstein and his feet and his photos of other people's feet throughout this enormous episode. I've never taken a shoe shine photo in my life, by the way. The closest I've ever come is this, which is a photograph I took in Beijing in about 2007. And if anyone out there can tell me what the hell is going on in this photo, I will reward them with a hot buttered crumpet. Now, one of the problems I've had when making this film, apart from sweating like a lunatic on the hottest day of the year, is that there, and also finding photographs of photographers' feet, which is like an extra thing that I didn't need, but anyway. One of the big problems I've had is literally narrowing it down. There are so many photographs of feet and shoes out there that I could do nothing but show you my favourite foot and shoe photographs for the next 2 or 3 hours. But don't worry, I'm not going to do that. However, I am going to show you a few of my foot favourites just to get you in the mood. So let's take a look at this great one by Tom Wood called Finding a Pair, taken at Great Homer Street Market in Dingle in Liverpool in 1990. Incidentally, I will also do an entire film on Tom Wood one day, soon, I promise. But for now, let's just quickly look at this one. I love everything about this shot. The dangling shoe, this woman's fag, and the kid here who is obviously only there under sufferance with his mum and would much rather be elsewhere. Like all good photos, this one makes you start to write stories in your head. But unusually for a foot photograph, there are no actual feet in it. All these people presumably have feet and shoes, but we can't see any of them. So it's a bit of an exception. And because this is now a rod I've made for my own back, here is a photograph of Tom Wood himself at the recent fantastic retrospective of his work at the Walker Galleries in Liverpool, sporting a fairly trendy looking pair of trainers. Or how about we take a quick look at this photo by Martin Parr from his Nonconformist book, taken in Hebden Bridge in West Yorkshire in the early 1970s. This photo is simply magic, and it all hinges on 2 feet, the one at the top of the ladder and the other one hovering in mid-air next to it, as if the window wiper, who's dressed to impress in a suit and hat, is levitating or even about to fall. I could look at this photograph for ages, but I won't because there are so many more, including this photo of Parr himself wearing a pair of sandals, would you believe? This is from his ongoing autoportrait series and was taken in Colombo in 2003, where presumably it's hot and sweaty enough that sandals are acceptable footwear. It's also worth pointing out that in Western street photography, at least, when we talk about foot photographs, we're usually talking about shoe photographs. Bare feet are still a relative rarity, although they are going to show up in some of the photographs we're going to look at later on. But this, therefore, is a perfect time for me to look at one of my very, very favourite foot photos of all time, which does feature a barefoot, and it's this one by Richard Kalvar, which manages to be absolutely surreal, but also just a brilliant example of street feet and shoes photography. Kalvar is definitely one of those photographers who gets feet, a fetishist even, and we might look at some of his other feet shots later on, but for now, let's just marvel at this one. Seriously, it's bloody fantastic. The composition, for a start. A lesser photographer might have tried to get the whole of what I'm assuming is a live, not a dead, hippie lying on top of their car here. Remember, this photograph was taken in Greenwich Village in New York City in 1970, when hippies did apparently just lie around shoeless in a state of undress atop their station wagons on every single corner. But Kalvar knew the power of a disembodied shoeless foot in the foreground was too good to ignore. and then he managed to get a bloke eating an ice lolly in close proximity to a giant foot. And then, to cap it all, a bloke playing his guitar and harmonica on the far right of frame in sandals. It might even be Bob Dylan himself, who knows? Or possibly Martin Parr. This photo is near foot perfection. My only quibble would be that Kalvar has cut off the ice lolly eating bloke's feet, so we don't know whether he's sporting bare feet, flip-flops, or even snowshoes. But then again, we can always use our imagination and mentally put whatever footwear we fancy on him. Now, I spent a long, way, way too long amount of time looking for a shot of Richard Kalvar's own feet online. And I thought I was going to be thwarted, but then finally I found this one, which alas doesn't show him barefoot or in sandals, but instead in a rather conservative and sensible pair of black lace-ups. A bit like Lewis Hine. Assuming, of course, that those are Kalvar's actual feet. There's a chance, though, that it could be a bit of trickery, and those feet belong to someone else, hidden behind the poster. I guess we'll never know. And we can't really look at feet photographs, I think, without including this corker by the late, recently departed Thomas Hoepker, or Hoepker. In fact, I pronounced that right because I don't know how to pronounce his name. And this photograph is of what is described in the blurb as a peasant kissing the feet of the Shah of Iran in 1962. So this could even be considered another shoeshine photo of a kind. Obviously, we have to take Hoepker's word that those are the Shah of Iran's actual shoes. They don't look expensive enough for me. They look more like Lewis Hine's or Richard Kalvar's shoes. And if you zoom in a bit, you can see that the Shah of Iran, if indeed that was him, has recently trod through some mud. And so maybe he was getting the peasant to lick it off. Anyway, whatever is actually going on here, this is a fantastic, powerful political image. Especially when you consider that the Shah, Mohammad Reza Pahlav, fled, presumably on his feet, to America when the Iranian Revolution took place 16 years later in 1979. And quite joyously for me, here is a photograph of Thomas Hoepker tying his own shoelace in 2007 in a great portrait by Peter Marlowe. This is probably the best photographer and their shoes portrait I've ever seen or been able to find, even though it includes a gratuitous and slightly distracting rum advert in the background there. And finally, let's just marvel at this great Shirley Baker photo taken in Manchester in the 1960s, which seems to me to encapsulate everything about being a child and playing at being a grown-up simply by the presence of those oversized shoes the little girl is clomping about in. It's funny, but it's also slightly unsettling and heartbreaking all at once. Are they her dad's shoes? Does he know she's stolen them? Does she even have a dad? Again, photographs that make you ask questions are usually good photographs. Unfortunately, I can only find one photo of Shirley Baker's feet, and here we can only actually see her right foot. And again, sadly, she's not wearing a pair of massive outside men's shoes, but a simple slip-on of undetermined colour. Now, like I said, I could just keep on listing foot and shoe photographs for the next hour, but I want to try and probe a little deeper. I want to find out why there are so many feet and shoe photographs, what they might mean, and try to sniff out the photographers who get the importance of photography, as opposed to those who, for some reason or other, might believe that photographing feet is somehow beneath them. Because it's undeniably true that while most great or even decent photographers might have one or two foot or shoe snaps in their back catalogue, there are some out there who have way more than their fair share. The fetishists, maybe. So I want to try and discover why photographing feet and shoes floats their collective boats. And it's also worth considering that as a street photographer, you know, your feet are incredibly important to you. We do a hell of a lot of walking around. One of the first bits of advice you're always given as a street photographer is get a pair of comfortable shoes. And one photographer who certainly knew about this and who gave a bit of advice, which has always stuck with me, is Ansel Adams, who said that photography is all about knowing where to stand. And Adams himself certainly knew where to stand, or indeed jump, because when I was looking for photos of his feet, I came across this extraordinary shot of the man himself clicking his heels in midair in, I assume, the mid-1950s or so. I know nothing else about this photo other than I found it on an Ansel Adams Facebook group where it was labelled Adams having fun and giving pleasure to others, and make of that what you will. Anyway, what is certain, as I think I've just said, is that street photographers, we spend a lot of time walking about on our feet. And so it's unsurprising that every now and again we might turn the camera down to take photographs of them. And one of the best foot-orientated photographers I've found so far is Dorothea Lange. So most people who know a bit about photography know about Dorothea Lange because of her incredibly famous 1936 photograph, Migrant Mother. Here it is, and it's probably one of the most well-known and recognisable photographs of the 20th century. It's iconic. It's also, as you'll notice, completely footless and shoeless, so it might seem a strange image for us to be considering in this episode devoted to feet. But here's the thing, there are other versions of this photo that do include feet. But before I plunge in, it's worth considering a bit more about Dorothea Lange and discovering how she came to make this image in the first place. She started off as a studio photographer, a portrait photographer, in San Francisco in the 1920s. She had her own studio. Here is a photo of the site where it was taken a bit later on in the 1940s. And there she would take very nice but rather conventional portraits of the middle classes and artists in the city. Portraits like this. These are apparently the Haas brothers, or this one, which is just called Catton Family Portrait. And I would very quickly draw your attention to this astonishing comb over here on the elder Catton. Although she did also take at least one less conventional foot-orientated shot of a woman called Wallen. Here are her feet, and here's her face. At the time, Lange was married to the famous painter of Western landscapes and cowboys, who was called Maynard Dixon. And here is a photo of Dixon in the process of painting a very tumescent cactus, but pictured not with Dorothea Lange. I couldn't find a picture of them together, but actually that's his third wife, Edith Hamlin, and this was taken in 1942. Now, annoyingly here, we can't really see what shoes Dixon is wearing, but he was a massive cowboy, and so I bet he's got an impressive pair of leather boots on underneath those wide-legged trousers, maybe even with spurs. And you can see that his third wife, Edith, has definitely got a nice pair of lace-up boots on, too. Anyway, Dorothea Lange, remember her? She actually got divorced from Maynard Dixon in 1935, and she also gave up her studio and started to travel the country and taking photos of the Great Depression, which had been ravaging America since the 1929 stock market crash. And she effectively became a very early documentary reportage photographer, and she was brilliant at it. So she went from photographing the well-off and comfortable to those far less fortunate, although some of those might also have recently been well-off. Who knows? In 1933, she took this photograph, White Angel Breadline, which again doesn't contain a single foot or shoe, but lots of hats on the heads of men waiting in line outside a soup kitchen. Although, if you hunt about a bit, you can find the contact sheet for that famous image. And there's also this far less well-known alternate version, which shows, that's right, the shoes of the central bloke. And what does this tell us? Not much really, other than newspapers will often opt for the closer shot rather than the wide, which usually contains the shoes. So the shoeless photo that was syndicated got Dorothea Lange a job with the Farm Security Administration, and she was free to travel and document what was going on in America at the time. And by now she had got married to the agricultural economist Paul Schuster Taylor, or in this case Schuster Taylor. Seen here with just a single visible shoe, together with Dorothea Lange in 1953, as they struggle to set up a brand new fangled tripod for a selfie. Here's another earlier photo, this one actually taken by Schuster Taylor, that shows Lange on the roof of their car, modelling a very nice pair of, would you say they're sandals with socks? I'm not sure. And then again here, still sitting on the roof of her car, maybe she's got stuck up there, but this time in a pair of what looked like Converse canvas boots. And anyway, in March 1936, Lange was driving through Napomo in California. I'm not sure if she was wearing sandals or boots, when she came across an encampment of migrant pea pickers. And in this case, the word migrant just refers to anyone who had left their original home in the States and travelled looking for work because of the Great Depression. They were also referred to as Okies, as many had originally come from Oklahoma. These are photos Lange took of farmers who had moved their entire family and all their worldly possessions. But not all Okies were from Oklahoma. Got that? Right, moving on. So in this case, the pea crop had failed, so it was cold and wet, which probably meant that Lange was wearing her boots, not her sandals. And anyway, she saw this family and initially took this shot. Then she moved a bit closer and took this shot, in which you can see the migrant mother, whose name was later revealed to be Florence Owens Thompson, and four of her six children, including one of the kids' feet, here. Lange herself said of the situation, "I did not ask her name or history. She told me her age, that she was 32. She said that they had been living off frozen vegetables from the surrounding fields and birds that the children had killed. She had just sold the tyres from her car to buy food. There she sat in that lean-to tent with her children huddled around her and seemed to know that my pictures might help. And so she helped me. There was a sort of equality about it. The pea crop at Nipomo had frozen and there was no work for anybody." Lange only took seven shots in total, and the next five are all closer, slightly posed portraits. But what's interesting to me is that of those five, the only one that doesn't contain any feet is the famous migrant mother shot. So you can see the kids' feet here, 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 and here, but not in this final photograph. The feet in question are wearing homemade knitted baby's booties, but they were deemed not heart-rending enough when compared to the thoughtful and slightly shame-faced final version. But what's telling is that Lange tried to include feet in the shots to begin with because she knew their potential power. And again, when you start to look through her work and her archive, you can see that time and time and again, she would take foot and shoe shots as a political statement. Feet as an indicator or a metric of poverty is a recurring theme and topic in Lange's work. So to look at just a few of these, we have several shots titled Tulare County Baby with Club Feet Wearing Homemade Splints Inside Shoes, 1939, which are self-explanatory really. Nothing screams poverty and hardship more than babies with club feet and shoes with homemade splints. Or how about this one, which is titled People Living in Miserable Poverty, Elm Grove, Oklahoma, 1936. And there's little more that indicates miserable poverty, in America at least, than bare and dirty feet. This is what I meant earlier on when I said that some photographers are alert to the political power of foot photography, because the state of your subject's feet can be a big indicator of their class and the wider state of the nation they come from. Dorothea Lange's eye was extremely keen and honed to the power of feet. This one is called Alabama Plowgirl, 1936, and here it's not so much the bare feet that contain the power, but rather that rope there, which can't help but make you wonder if the girl is tied up or harnessed in some way. Is she doing this out of choice, or is she being forced? A wide shot might tell us more, but this closer framing raises more questions. Lange knew that a foot photograph can be very revealing about a subject, while simultaneously retaining that subject's anonymity and preserving their dignity. And it's a balancing act that she did and pulled off again and again with skill and aplomb. I also really like this one, which is described as a 57-year-old African-American sharecropper's feet with dimes around her ankles to prevent headaches, Hines County, Mississippi, June 1936. This is a bizarre and curious photo, and it raises so many questions. Do dimes around your ankles really prevent headaches? I don't know, but I will be trying this technique out myself with some 10-pence pieces, and I'll let you know how I get on next time. Obviously, working during the 1930s in the Great Depression gave Lange many, many opportunities to take great telling feet and foot shots. Here is a contact feet sheet taken of a seamstress in 1934, and the final chosen image was this one, which was published with the caption, "A Sign of the Times." And though it's not strictly about the feet, the mended salvaged stocking here is another powerful image. When the Depression was over, Lange's photography led her to be awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship in 1941. She was the first woman ever to be honoured in this way. And she kept on throughout her career looking down and taking more feet and shoe shots, whether they were political, like this one, which is called Last Ditch, Walking Wounded Man with Crutch from 1954, or a lighter series on cable car commuters in San Francisco in 1956. Although there's definitely some peril in this shot called Stepping Off, which reminds me a bit of that Martin Parr shot we looked at earlier on. Or take a look at this one called Winter, California, 1955. I know nothing about this photograph other than it shows a woman asleep in the day, but the best element is all in the feet. They're probably tan lines, or it could be dirt, but whatever it is, it's a fantastic rare detail. Few photographers have ever looked at feet as closely as Dorothea Lange. In 1958, Lange went abroad she traveled the world, but she mainly went to Asia, and she kept on shooting feet. These shots here are from Indonesia, Burma, and Vietnam. And the latest one I can find is actually from South America, from Venezuela in 1960, which is incredibly menacing with its machete and axe. But why did Dorothea Lange have such a foot fascination? Well, there's a couple of details here that I've deliberately left out and held back until now. The first one was that growing up, she had a very hard life. Her family were German immigrants, and her father abandoned them when she was 12 years old, and they moved around a lot, so she knew poverty. So when the Great Depression hit, she had a sympathy and empathy with a lot of her subjects. But the other detail was that when she was just 7 years old, Dorothea Lange contracted polio, which left her with a slightly withered right leg and a twisted and crabbed right foot. She was actually unable to put her heel down on her right foot properly. And when you consider the amount of equipment and the size of the equipment back then that she had to schlap about, you can see that this disability, her own disability, gave her a real empathy and interest in feet in general. She said, "I think polio was the most important thing that happened to me. It formed me, guided me, instructed me, helped me, and humiliated me. All those things at once. So now, when you look at a photo like this one she took of a woman's foot in Vietnam in 1958 and the awkward pose it's adopting, it means a lot more when you know about Lange's relationship with her own feet. And not only that, but in 1957, Lange took a series of photos, feet selfies, of her own polio-afflicted foot for a series titled Where I Live. And you can see the contact sheet here. And this is probably the clearest photo I can find, revealing the exact shape of her foot. And now imagine how hard that must have made certain aspects of her life." And that photo is a good segue for me to start exploring another little subgenre in this predictably mammoth film, which is photographers' own feet selfies, which is quite niche, but it's still thrown up quite a few good images. And the first one I want to have a look at is by a German photographer called Willy Ruge. Or it could be Willy Ruge, I'm not entirely sure. Anyway, it's utterly bananas, and it was taken in 1931 by Mr. Ruge, or Willy, or however you want to call him, who was a photographer and an aeronautics engineer. And this photograph is called Seconds Before Landing, I Photograph Myself During a Parachute Jump. So what we're looking at now is self-explanatory, but that doesn't in any way diminish from its power and the sheer lunacy of doing such a thing. I know it might not be such a great image, especially now when everyone and their dog can GoPro themselves stupid in the midst of all kinds of daredevil nonsense, but back then this was a truly radical photo, and to me it even looks like Willy Ruge was wearing some patterned socks, maybe from Paths of Glory. That's a very niche Kubrick joke for those few people out there who will actually get it. Willy Ruge's parachuting foot selfie makes most others look tame by comparison. But let's have a go anyway. There's this one by Gray Villette from 1954, as he sits dangling his legs over the side of a skyscraper in Manhattan with normal non-patterned socks. And here's a good one of Lee Freelander with Jim Dine in 1969, as Freelander, on the left there, bares his soul for the camera. Here's Harry Callahan from 1942, playing with reflections and truncating himself. And then here's Vivian Mayer doing a similar kind of thing 13 years later in 1954. I also really like this undated Vivian Mayer selfie with shoes in a shoe shop rather than on her own feet. I suppose she might have gone and bought a pair shortly afterwards, although she probably went and spent all her money on film instead. Just a few more of these, I promise, before we go and move on to something else, but I also really like this one, which was taken by Neil Armstrong in 1969 on the moon, or depending on how much of a conspiracy nutter you are, a photo taken by Stanley Kubrick. And it's a trend that continues to this very day. Here's not one, but two, both the left and right feet of Dirty Harry, whose real name, and I pray that I can pronounce this right, is Charalampos Kidionakis. Although his left foot there looks quite clean, not dirty at all. And here's Jeff Meremelstein, again, with his submerge feet by Jeff Meremelstein. I told you we'd be coming back to him, and there's more of him later on too. There's also been a rather recent strange phenomenon of natural history wildlife photographers taking foot selfies of their own toes showing how many mosquitoes are biting their toes. So this one is by Joel Sartore in Alaska in 2015, and 1 year later this is by Amos Chappell in Siberia in 2016. Both men did this voluntarily and to make some ecological point or another, but I can't imagine anything worse, so let's swiftly move on. The last set of foot selfies I want to look at are slightly different again. Regular viewers will know that I'm a big fan of Garry Winnogrand, and he's a photographer that shot with a 28mm lens and so frequently got feet in his shots as a matter of course. Take a look at this one, with not one, not two, but three nuns and a woman with a bandaged foot on crutches. Or this foot-tastic classic of six women on a bench. Or this amazing one here, that again contrasts working feet and non-working feet. All these photographs are so effective precisely because you can see all of the feet involved. Now there are a few Winnogrand feet selfies out there. This one is probably the best, where he's got his feet and the feet of all the other people all beautifully in frame, and then there's the whole gamut of shoes on display, from open-toed sandals to lace-ups and trainers. But these aren't the foot selfies I want to look at today. Winogrand's photographic story is complicated by the fact that he shot relentlessly, and towards the end of his life he stopped developing or looking at his work, so he never caught up with himself. So when he died prematurely of cancer in 1984, aged just 56, he left behind thousands of unprocessed rolls of film that he had never seen. And then when people started to posthumously develop these rolls and try and make sense of them, there was a school of thought that said he had lost his eye. People looked at those late photos and said that he was not what he used to be. Even John Sarkowski, who had championed Winogrand throughout his life, and here is a photo of Sarkowski showing his shoes while being photographed by Winogrand in a photograph by Lee Freelander from 1975, said that the late pictures were willful, pointless, and self-indulgent. And one of the reasons for that is that when they finally got round to printing his late rolls, they printed absolutely everything. And so there were lots of photographs that turned out like this, which, as you can see, are foot selfies. Numerous repeated shots of Winogrand's feet, and they are boring, repetitive, and not really worthy of consideration. But they don't tell the full story, because none of these foot photos were shot to prove a point. They were just taken in the act of loading and winding on his Leica. He would pop a roll in and then fire off one or two shots pointing down at the ground. And also at the time, Winogrand was divorced, and so when he was out shooting, frequently he was accompanied by his young daughter, whose foot might occasionally creep into shot, or even be sitting on his shoulders as he worked, like we can see in these two photographs here. So these foot selfies are not really the same thing. They're not done out of a sense of fun. They're just the byproduct of Winogrand's practice and his personal circumstances. And if you want to know more about this little nugget of photographic history and Garry Winogrand, then I strongly suggest you seek out and watch the entire documentary about him called All Things Are Photographable, which is not easy to say actually, photographable, which came out a few years ago. And there you can hear Thomas Romer talk about exactly this point, but more eloquently and in greater detail. So what next? Well, before we take a look at another foot-centric photographer, I think I should issue a warning, and that's a warning about Googling for something as ambiguous and vague as foot photographs or foot selfies, because there is an entire alternate universe of foot-centric wank fodder out there that you could very easily slip into and get lost. So in this episode, I'm most definitely not going to be talking about the work of one photographer in particular, and that's Elmer Batters, as the so-called foot fetish king. Here is a photo of Batters himself, taken sometime in the 1950s, holding a woman's foot with a tape measure about his neck, as he was very particular about the size of foot that he would photograph. He's also showing off his own pair of slip-ons, and maybe, just maybe, a pair of Stanley Kubrick Lolita socks, which would be appropriate. And Batters made photographs that looked like this. These are the tame ones, by the way, that I can still show here without getting shut down or banned. But if you like this sort of thing, there are, surprise, surprise, two huge Taschen books all about him. And one small biographical detail that I did find very funny about Elmer Batters, apart from his name, is that he apparently served during World War II on a submarine where, according to the Taschen website, he first became aware that his sexual tastes were different from his shipmates. the mind boggles. But if for any reason you're more interested in looking at photos of men's feet than women's feet, you don't have to go the Elmer Batters route. You can always go and look at this website, which is called Wiki Feet. And there you can see the feet of virtually anyone you wish. Look, they've even got this great shot of photographer Helmut Newton in a pair of high heels. And amusingly, people who liked Helmut Newton's feet apparently also liked Paul Newman, Keanu Reeves, and even Gerard Depardieu. And here's a photo of Gerard Depardieu with his poorly left foot in some kind of orthopedic boot. WikiFeet has photos of the feet of so many celebrities and professional and amateur foot models that you could, if you so chose, spend the rest of your life doing nothing but while stroking yourself into a foot-fueled frenzy. However, that's not what we're going to do, honest, although we might come back to WikiFeet in a bit. Instead, what we're going to do now is look at a photographer whose work I absolutely adore, but someone who you maybe wouldn't initially associate with foot and shoe photographs, and that is the late great Swedish photographer Lars Tunbjork. Now, throughout this film, I'm going to refer to him purely as Lars, which is not due to any kind of over-familiarity or anything, but simply because I'm not 100% sure on how to pronounce Tunbjork or Tunbjork. And because I've mucked up the pronunciation of so many other photographers' names in the past, I thought I'd avoid this by just calling him Lars. Although I do feel that I know him quite well after having studied his foot photography and his photography in general for so long. As with many other photographers, there's a real problem finding photographs of Lars's feet. Here's a lovely photograph of him, but look, with the feet cropped out, which is a crying shame. But fortunately, if you do a bit of digging about and you get hold of this great and sometimes affordable retrospective of his work, you can, if you start flicking through the pages, find this fantastic photograph of him taken whilst chasing John Travolta through the streets of Stockholm in 1983. This was, of course, that famous incident when Travolta went rogue while on a promotional tour of Europe for Staying Alive, which was the ill-fated Saturday Night Fever sequel directed by Sylvester Stallone. And incidentally, if you want to see Sylvester Stallone's feet, then all you have to do is put his name into WikiFeet. Yes, that site again. And this is what you get. A gallery of about 50 photographs of Sylvester Stallone's feet taken over the course of his long and glorious career, including blurry and out-of-focus shots like this, or even a close-up of what is allegedly his left foot in a flip-flop. Or maybe that's Martin Parr. Anyway, back to Lars before we all die of old age. Lars was born in a small Swedish town called Borås in 1956, and he discovered photography as a teenager and rapidly became one of Sweden's leading news photographers. He initially started working in black and white, and here's just a couple of his early shots in which you can instantly see that Lars was one of those photographers who got feet and their importance. Please note the sandal in this photo of a footballing monk from 1983. Lars's sandal game was very, very strong, as we'll continue to see throughout his career. But it was when he discovered colour and started shooting with flash or medium format that his voice and his unique take on the world exploded. So obviously I could spend the next hour or so just looking at Lars's photographs, and it would be a great use of both of our times. However, I'm going to try and focus and only look at his work that contains feet and shoes. And his work can be roughly divided into two different parts. The Swedish work that he undertook in his own home, and then the stuff that he did whilst on assignment for various magazines and newspapers, mainly the New York Times, which is where he was mainly employed throughout the 90s. So his Swedish work, which we're gonna look at first, is full of feet shots, and especially sandals with socks. This is a very famous shot. It was the front cover of that retrospective I showed you earlier on, and it sums up very nicely the Lars aesthetic, which actually was known in Sweden as Tunbjorka, annoyingly, and not Larsish, which will be far easier for me to pronounce. And Tunbjorka is a blend of extreme colour, wit, and slightly weird melancholy, all things that are equally represented, I think, by wearing socks with sandals. Lars himself said of his work that, "I'm interested in mixed emotions, wit, sadness, humour and despair." Again, all of which can be attributed to wearing socks and sandals. And it's fascinating to me that earlier on we saw how Dorothea Lange was able to use shots of bare feet as a metric or indicator of poverty in Depression-era America, But now, how Lars is able to use feet in socks and sandals as a metric of how Sweden was rushing headlong into a kind of capitalist consumerist nightmare. I'm going to show you a few different Swedish photos now, all of which highlight feet and shoes and often use them as the punchline in a joke. As you can see time and again, Lars is happy to chop off heads and render the owners of the shoes anonymous, as long as we can see their footwear or their bare feet. This one is particularly astonishing. There's three different sets of feet here, and the singing woman with a tambourine has a bandaged upper thigh, and the bloke in the middle looks as if he's just realised he's existing in a level of existential Scandinavian hell from which there is no possible escape. Well, check this out. Another accordion, and the anonymous man here with his arms folded listens on. We can't see his face, it's not important. His arms tell us that he's not happy. But look at his feet, socks in slip-ons. Lars's flash isn't even powerful enough to fully illuminate them, but you get the idea. Even in shadow, it's a thing that shouldn't be overexposed, lest it causes the viewer to turn to stone. Again and again, Lars turned his gaze downwards to find humour in shoes and feet. Take a look at this one. Or this utterly bizarre one. A lesser photographer would have focused just on the dancing couple, if indeed they are dancing, but Lars includes the shoes. And here again, in this photograph, taken in Stockholm in 1990, it would be so easy to focus just on the face of the man trying to keep the rain off his head. But the great thing is that Lars has shot it wide so that we can see what's going on the ground. A soaked pair of shoes on a newspaper, as if that might somehow help. This photo is almost the dictionary definition of shutting the stable door long after the horse has bolted. And it wasn't just in his native Sweden. Whenever Lars went out on assignment, he always knew to keep an eye out for great shoe shots. This is from Paris Fashion Week in 2004, and then this one is from the Cannes Film Festival in 1997. And finally, this quite well-known one from an assignment on wealthy American ranchers in 1995. But there was one long-term project which Lars worked on for many years throughout the 1990s and then was published in 2001. And it took him all over the world, from Tokyo to America and all over Europe. And it's a project to which feet are absolutely central. Although I don't know that anyone's actually looked at this before from such an angle. And that is his book Contour or Office. So, like I just said, this was a project that is now quite well known, but I don't think anyone's ever identified or examined the significance of feet and shoes in it before. The very first double page spread in the book is this one, which pairs an empty grey bank in Sioux Falls, America in 1998 with this utterly bizarre photo of a man in a grey suit inexplicably holding a fake, at least we have to presume it's a fake, foot in a light brown, or maybe that's even a taupe coloured sock. There's no explanation at all. All we learn is that the photo was taken at the Export Centre Tokyo 2 years earlier in 1996. But once you start to notice feet in Office, suddenly they're absolutely everywhere, feet and shoes. Take a look at this great one taken in a lawyer's office in New York in 1997. It's another shoeshine photo. Remember how we looked at those a couple of years ago when I first started this episode? I think this might be one of the greatest shoeshine photos ever taken. It's completely unusual. For a start, it's indoors, not outdoors. The shoe shiner presumably makes his way through the office, shining employees' shoes on request, but it's the total lack of interaction that makes this a great photograph. The lawyer is focused on his work, or at least pretending to focus on his work. He's utterly determined not to acknowledge the shoe shiner, while the shoe shiner isn't looking at the shoes he's shining, but rather staring right at his client, almost daring him to look up and concede that he's having his shoes shined. Or maybe, just maybe, the lawyer is doing the shoe shiner a favour and checking a contract for him in return for a quick spit and polish. We'll never know. Although this is a world away from Daguerre's pioneering shot from 1838, but has humanity's lot improved in the interim? Who can say? Certainly not me. That photo isn't actually typical of the shoe photos in Office, where Lars is continually sort of snuffling away under desks and tables and continually revealing that which is not normally seen. He illuminates and reveals the soul as well as the souls of work and commerce. Everywhere there are kneeling employees praying for redemption, or maybe just for it to be the weekend so they can finally escape their grey prisons and go home. Maybe to campsites where they can once more wear sandals with socks while playing the accordion. Lars literally shines a light on what goes on beneath the surface in offices the world over, and it's not very pretty. Humans are creatures that need to walk and roam the planet, but here, under Lars's gaze, they are revealed to have been hobbled and trapped by wires and cables and cheap items of furniture. Legs and feet are constantly sticking out or jammed into places too small for them to function properly, like battery-farmed animals. I'm often reminded of the Wicked Witch of the East and how she was crushed by Dorothy's house in The Wizard of Oz. And this one is my absolute favourite, if that's the right word, where we see a worker who has effectively become a kind of cyborg with the head of a computer monitor, but one who is trying vainly to relax by slipping off their shoes only to reveal their dirty, stained white socks underneath. Office ends with a quote from the Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu from 400 BC. And here is not a photograph of Lao Tzu, obviously, but a print of him wearing a truly sensational pair of slippers, although it's impossible to tell whether he's also got socks on. Anyway, it might sound pretentious to quote Lao Tzu, but in this case, it's completely exact and fitting. Come closer to the common mystery, attend to the ordinary. It is wisdom that sees the ordinary with amazement. And that's exactly what makes these photographs great. The courage and wisdom that Lars had to choose a project and subject back in the 1990s that was so quotidian and common, yet so under-examined as office workers and their lives, and by extension, their feet. And if we're going to get all pretentious, I might as well go the whole hog and chuck in a quote by the 18th century German philosopher George William Friedrich Hegel, who said, "What is familiar is not understood precisely because it is familiar." And here's a very nice engraving of Hegel showing exactly the kind of shoes he was sporting in the 1800s. And that truism that we often ignore or fail to understand what's beneath our feet or even on our feet is something that Lars himself acknowledged when he said, "I'm most interested in the ordinary. I want to examine the most obvious things from every angle." And that's exactly what he did in office, because what, in a way, could be more ordinary than feet and shoes? So that was Lars Tunbjork's office, and I just want to take a very quick look at another kind of subgenre or category of feet and shoe photographs, because it was one and something that Lars understood and contributed to himself. So this is a photograph from 1988, taken in what I presume is a Swedish amusement park in Skara, Somaliland. And you can see that this is a photograph entirely about feet and shoes. On the right-hand side, we have a giant dinosaur's foot, and that's contrasted with the much smaller human feet in slip-ons but without socks here behind this sign. And this was Lars's contribution to a type of foot photograph that is all about perspective and scale, contrasting animal and human feet, which we can date back to 1946 when Elliot Erwitt invented it. And here is that shot that changed photographic history. And I'm going to stick my neck out here and say that Erwitt did indeed invent this contrasting animal, human, foot, shoe, paw, perspective shot, whatever you want to call it. Now, I talked a bit about this and Erwitt's use of it way back in the Show and Tell Dog Special episode 7, where we looked briefly at the contact sheet, revealing that it was a massive crop. And conveniently back then, I also dug up this shot from sometime in the mid-1990s, showing Erwitt's own feet, as he went on to repeat that shot, almost his signature shot, again and again, this time with a corgi wearing a tin hat, but he did it repeatedly. This is quite a famous one with human boots, big Great Dane paws, and then a tiny chihuahua in a hat, and also this one from Paris in 1989 with just human feet and a leaping dog. And everyone you can imagine has been at it ever since Elliot Erwitt first got down on his ass in New York City in 1946 and took that photo. Here is just a brief selection. First of all, here's Shirley Baker again at a dog show in 1966. And then Jill Friedman in this bizarre yet brilliant one from Halloween in Manhattan sometime in the 1970s. And here, because I'm sticking with this all the way to the bitter end, is a foot photo selfie by Jill Friedman from 1975. Dougie Wallace more recently did a project called Well Healed, which featured numerous examples of the contrast in size between human feet and small dogs, and here's just a couple of those. And here too is a shot of one of Dougie's feet, just about right at the bottom there. I've also done it, of course I have. Here's a couple of dog and human feet photographs that I've taken recently. And the final photograph I want to look at like this is by Jeff Meremelstein, yet again. I said we'd be coming back to him, from New York City sometime in the late 1980s or early 1990s. And like Lars before him, he's twisted the Urwitt standard by contrasting not dog's feet and human feet, but in this case, a pet iguana's feet and human feet. So I've just seen the time, and even though I've got tons more foot-related stuff to talk about and photographs to look at, I'm going to stop there, and I'm going to split this episode into two different halves, a pair of foot episodes, if you wish, or another leg, which will be coming later on, probably in about 2027 or 2026, given the amount of stuff I have to do. So thanks very much for watching. We'll come back to feet, and I'll continue to analyze them and look at them from all different angles a bit later on. In the meantime, if you get a chance, please try and buy a copy of Mostly False Reports from me if you haven't already got one. I've got tons of copies and I really would like to shift them. Thanks for watching. Yeah, just keep an eye, and the next episode in this foot special will be along soon. Bye.